So first off, let's talk a little bit about the shader tree. This is something that is not widely understood, even amongst our own community. And it's one of those things that I'm pretty passionate about showing off because when I first came over to Modo, I came over from, I had been a Lightwave user for years prior. I had moved over to Maya, got very comfortable with Hypershade and node-based shading. And I came over and saw the shader tree, and I'm like, what is this? I don't understand this. And a lot of people run into that same exact, situation coming into Modo. They're like, I don't understand the shader tree. And I stumbled my way through it. I looked at a lot of videos and a lot of examples from people like Yazan, Michael Blackborn, Greg Leuenberger. It seems to do like a new video on the shader tree every year to kind of show people how to use it. But the shader tree can get very dense very quickly with lots and lots of different materials. And there's some ways that you can manage that and make life a lot easier using the shader tree. And the thing I like about the shader tree is the local versus global shading relationship that you can create inside the tree. And you can also connect up to node-based shading, which we'll talk a little bit about later. Some really cool stuff that you can do with normals and things of that sort with the node-based shading. Just a small example of what you can do with node-based shading. You can even create a triplanar projection thing. There's some great examples on our forums. Please check it out. All right, so this is just a basic environment that we use oftentimes to kind of show off basic gaming environments and stuff like that, and also basic VFX environments. But it has a lot of great examples in it as far as how our shader tree can be used. But before we go into some of those specifics, let's talk a little bit about the shader tree itself and how it's organized, right? So I'm going to make sure my inactive or same is active, and I want to turn my visibility off to make sure that you guys don't see all those texture locators that are in the way. Just take a look at this. All right, so the shader tree is fundamentally a tree-based system, of course. And we've talked about the item list. The item list is a tree-based system as well. But the shader tree contains all of your materials. And one of the things that people get caught on straight off the start using Modo's shader tree is the what is a base shader, right? Well, what Modo's done is Modo has essentially an Uber shader, which if I grab this material right here, this is Modo's standard Uber shader. Right now the shading model is set to energy conserving. That is one of the shading models in Modo. As of 9.01, we added the physically based shading model. And so this is an Uber shader that really contains all the primary things you'd expect to see, diffuse amount, say diffuse color, specular, roughness, reflection type, all, go on into material trans, which is the second section. That's where you get your transparent amount, subsurface, luminosity, and things of that sort. This Uber shader, really what this is actually just a material. Okay, it's common in our industry to call this a shader, but what Modo does is Modo kind of separates material attributes from shaders. And essentially, like if I take a look at this base shader right here, this is an actual item in the shader tree. And the base shader tells a surface how it's going to be shaded. And if you select the actual base shader itself, you can take a look at the properties, it explains this notion a little bit further. Like, what if I wanted to do something like while I'm rendering? Okay, this is not necessarily game related, but it communicates the idea very well. Modo has a very fast renderer. Right now I'm using the progressive renderer, the preview renderer right here. But what's going on right now is it's using irradiance caching while it renders. And irradiance caching is interpolated global illumination and makes it a lot faster. But in Modo, you can actually tell when you have a shader item in the shader tree that, you know what, everything beneath this base shader, I want it to be rendered using, for instance, Monte Carlo instead of indirect illumination, which is interpolated global illumination. And so this is a very important thing to communicate in that you have lots and lots of control how you shade items in your scene by manipulating the base shader. You also control the quality of the shading, like right here, the shading rate. The lower you bring that, the higher quality the shading it is, the more samples essentially that is going to be thrown at it. But you can do all sorts of other great stuff, like control the visibility of it to the camera, whether it receives shadows and stuff like that. But the shader controls how an object is shaded, while a material controls the attributes of that surface. What is the diffuse amount? What is the specular amount? What is the Fresnel and stuff like that. And so if I were to, bring these materials, like these are material groups right here for all my assigned materials, if I brought them above the base shader, those surfaces would know what their attributes are, but they wouldn't know how to shade because there'd be no shader. And this allows you to actually, you know, create relationships where you could actually have a shader that is shading an entire scene, and you can have a shader that is shading individual elements. We'll get into that a little bit deeper. But let me go ahead and show off the preview renderer really quickly, because the preview renderer is actually a really useful tool for a lot of reasons. I mean, A, it gives you a preview render of your actual item. And let's see, I'm going to go ahead and take... Okay. Might want to name the Twitch broadcast this, Webinar 3, UVs and Shader Tree. Yeah, I agree, Brandon. That sounds perfect. All right, Brandon is sending me messages on Skype. So if you have questions, ask them in the chat, and Brandon will field them, and he will bug me. All right, so the Shader Tree is a tool in a lot of different ways. Not only does it give you a nice, you know, preview of exactly what is going on, but it also allows you to go ahead and, you know, do really cool things with how you interact with your shading, because these are all different materials, right? And so if I have a scene and I want to take a look at my different materials, if I just click on an individual material, like I'm clicking on the plastic right here, that automatically selects that element in the shader tree for me. And so it becomes a really nice way of working. And if I turn on my wireframe view, even as I click inside the actual preview render, it will select all my items. And the preview render is insanely, insanely fast. And there's a lot of things you can do to tune it to have it be super high quality or have it be super, super fast. And I mean, really, really powerful stuff. Now, I want to have a camera because that camera for me is currently locked. If I want to unlock that, I can, you see how this camera right here is locked? I can right click on this. I can come on down to lock and unlock, and actually unlock that item right here. So lock, unlock. And now when I open this up, I'll be able to go ahead and let that render and navigate around my scene. You can see how well that allows me to navigate around the scene. It's really, really quite slick. Now, this scene, it does a good job for its purpose. It's, the idea is like, hey, you don't have much time to, you know, put a whole bunch of stuff together, you know, like if it's a set extension, so putting together a big broad set extension for something like you'd have to do for like the Discovery Channel or something like that, you have to throw it together really, really quickly. But one of the things that it's missing is, I think it's missing environmental texturing. And I think there's a distinction between the surface attributes of a material, like we'll say stone, or like as I zoom in here, wood. You see as I mouse over one area, I get a preview of that area, refining only, another hugely useful element inside the preview renderer. Let's go and let that finish up. But what I like to do is, you know, go ahead and create a base material and then figure out what kind of environment it actually exists in. You know, like, okay, so this scene right here, it looks like we're in a pretty, you know, kind of deserty, arid environment. So there'd be a lot of dust, right? And so maybe if we're going in, you know, for a desert, maybe this is like a Roman village in like the Middle East or something like that. Maybe there's oil fields nearby or something like that. And there's oil in the air. And so you create secondary materials that you can actually start layering up on top of these base materials. So you create your weathering, and you create your actual base material for the surface itself. And so let's talk a little bit more about that, right? First off, I'm going to go ahead and select my item right here, my wood boards. We already have planks, the planks material, as you can see here. But I'm going to assign a new material just to kind of articulate how you do this, right? Now, all you have to do, I'm going to come into component mode, you don't have to, is I'm going to hit the M, as in Mary, key to open up the polygon set material dialog, and we'll just say, you know what, I want to make that wood underscore planks just to make sure it's an entirely new material. You have all sorts of settings that you can set by default, the actual color, diffuse amount, specular amount, whether or not there's smoothing, you know, and if you want it to be the default material from this point forward that's automatically assigned to any new polys, you can make it the default. And so I'm going to say okay. And now we have a material group. And oftentimes people kind of attribute too much importance to the actual material groups themselves, but all these are, they're groups. They are just fundamentally a group, which is, you know, an icon that represents that it's a group. And groups inside of Modo's shader tree are fundamentally masks, all right? This is a really important thing to communicate. So I created a polygon mask by hitting the M key and assigned material to all the polys in this layer right here. And if I wanted to maybe just assign you know, a material to these polys I selected here. I left clicked and selected those polys. I can say M. I can name that something else, and it would be another new material added inside a material group. But the group is masking it based on polygon tags. And there's a lot of different ways that you can mask inside a Modo. And so right now I've got this item selected, right? And I assigned a polygon tag mask by hitting the M key to all the polys in this layer. But there's also an item mask type. And so since I have this selected, I can go ahead and hold down the shift key to expand my entire group so I expand the actual object itself. I can right click on that item, right? That item contains all that geometry that you see there. Come down here and say, you know what? I want to create an item mask. And this, as you can see now in the shader tree, I have a new group, it's a mask, that is identified as an item. And if I pull this material, this polygon tag mask, inside that item mask, it still will behave exactly the same way because I've masked based on item, and I've also masked based on polygon and the polygons themselves, you know, whatever I've selected when none is selected, all are selected in that particular item. And so it's very important to understand these relationships, because understanding item masks versus you know, polygon tag masks really allows you to kind of leverage some interesting elements. And like, even if you wanted to like select a whole bunch of different items, you know, like over here, for instance, like I select all of these and I right click on them and I create an item mask, it'll automatically create an item mask for all those items and name it according to those items. So it makes it much easier to manage and develop these shader trees really quickly and really easily. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to shut off that polygon tag mask, right? And I'm going to pause this. I always leave the preview renderer running. It's actually a bad habit. It's just because, you know, you really shouldn't do that because it's putting a lot of stress on your system, but it always handles it so freaking well. It's wonderful. All right, so let's go ahead and come on over to our planks and see, I've got my planks group here, and that's just a material group. Now, even though that doesn't actually have any polygon tag mass on it, nothing happens, right? Because there's nothing assigned to that. Now, if we take this out of that group, no, I don't want to reassign that. Thank you very much, though. And I select all the items inside of that, right? I'll just drag that out of that. And you see, now we suddenly have the proper materials and shading stuff on our surfaces. And the reason for that is because we got rid of the mask. That was masking it out from all the polys on the surface. And since we have this wood planks section turned off, if we turn that on, you see it overrides because it's above it. And it also has the polygon tag mask for this material group. And now if I turn it off, the item mask knows to mask out this wood material set from everything else in the scene. Now you also can mask based on selection sets. And so there's a lot of different ways that you can create masks inside of Modo. And I think understanding this masking concept helps tremendously in building out layered materials, and Modo's awesome at building out layered materials once you understand how to do it, both layered and layered blended materials. And we'll talk about both. An example of a layered material would be like a material that is composed of metal, wood, and plastic, for instance. And that's just a standard layered material where each material type is masked from one another. But a layered blended material would be something like a skin shader that has multiple levels of texture information that are blended together. And so this will further articulate the idea of a base shader, and also, more importantly, once we get there, nesting a base shader, and so it'll grow in complexity. All right, so now that we have a basic understanding of how the shader tree operates, what a shader is, what a material is, what an item mask is, and what a polygon tag mask is, let's talk about some of the ways that you build out your actual materials themselves. So we have a basic material here, and if I turn all these material types off, it's just, you know, it's the basic settings here for the material, and I can go ahead and modify that by selecting the material. And this gives you a nice way of being able to quickly and easily make I don't want to say rough, because roughness is something we use, but yeah, a rough material, a very basic material with very basic settings where I just have a diffuse color, not necessarily a texture representing it, you know, specular and Fresnel and stuff like that. And you can control all those with you know, image masks, but it's all here for you to create a basic material. And like, if I wanted to go ahead and yank that on down to 6 and raise the specular amount on up and bring my reflections on up. See, nothing's going on. Why? Because we don't have much of an environment right here. So we could actually go ahead and add an environment and get that to behave properly and get that reflecting all the good stuff in our scene. With a new physically based material, right now we're in energy conserving. If I switch over to physically based, you see what happened? All of a sudden everything changed. And the reason why is the reflection channel is gone. Specular controls the reflection channel now with the physically based material, because those are two things that are fundamentally linked. And so the physically based material does make things a lot easier as far as being able to, you know, set up much more complex materials very quickly and easily. So let me go ahead and over to an environment. And this is something that's very important, especially if, you know, you're working on game art. You probably want to have an environment. Even with our Unreal shader inside of Mari, they provided us with an HDR that was properly configured to get, you know, shading that was similar to what you would see inside of Unreal Engine. And so, you know, with modern games, you want to have an HDR. How do you do that? Well, in Modo, there's a couple different ways. You can do it all manually. Your environments are at the bottom of the shader tree. You see, you can expand that. I've got an environment item, and you have settings for the intensity of that environment, its visibility, and if I expand that, and then we have an environment material. And so hopefully this is starting to congeal for you. Like, you know, our environments even have a material themselves, and our environments could be based on physical settings. Like right now, this is an environment type of physically based daylight is what it's set to, but I don't have all my settings in place to actually produce the physically based daylight. I want to just go ahead and use an HDR because it's most likely what you guys are going to be using. So if I come on over to my preset browser, which you can open up with F6 on the keyboard. You can assign that to whatever you want, of course, and you come on down to environments. We have all these preset environments in place, and in this case, in 901, we added smart IBL environments, and they just produce awesome shading right off the start. They're great, great HDRs created by, I believe, Christian Block. I still hope I'm saying your name right. I always question that. But all you have to do is you can add whatever HDRs you want. And in this case of a smart IBL, they are properly balanced by a piece of software. They've had the location of a direct light, which would be the sunlight, put in the correct location. So they look much, much, much better. So let's put our Roman village. Yeah, right here, Red Rock Canyon Cliffs, right? That sounds good. I can double click on that and see that hugely high resolution. These automatically set this up. Look at this. Underneath environments, you have multiple environments. You can add a new environment just by coming up here to add layer, and I can add environment material. I can also, let's see, where are you? Yeah, we're going to have to add an environment material right up here, and that's going to be able to allow you to add new environments, which each contain their own components. And you see right here, look at this three-layer one. If I select this one environment, the environment lighting, you'll notice that everything is turned off. For the environment background, the background is visible to camera, but it's not actually affecting the lighting or reflection or refraction and environment reflection. And you see these images are properly configured for this. See, this is a reflection image. And this is a background image, it's 16K, and this is the actual lighting one for the actual environment itself. And so you can actually configure these to tailor and tune your lighting. And so I want this to be visible to indirect rays, and I'll relaunch this. We'll take a look at our beautiful lighting. You see how much prettier that already is. And so very, very cool. And I can turn visibility on here, and I can turn that off over here. For some reason, it just does not want to show up for me for some reason. I know I'm doing something wrong, but you actually can at least see the lighting on top of the surface. And so this is going to help you really get something that is analogous to the types of stuff that you're actually creating in an engine. All right, and so now that we've got some, you know, nicer lighting in place, now when you create an IBL that's already pre-configured, you're actually going to get a group here in the item list right at the bottom, and that's going to contain all your information like sunlight and stuff like that. Well, the actual direct light, well, it doesn't get rid of the existing lights, and so you see I've actually got two lights, and so I want to make sure that one is toggled off. So now you'll notice things really aren't blown out the way that they were before. So you can build out, you know, environments where one image is responsible for reflection, one is responsible for background, and one is responsible for lighting. And it makes your scenes definitely render a little bit faster, and usually it leads to higher quality because You know, for the actual lighting itself, the lighting image, you really don't need a very high resolution image. This is actually relatively high res, but like, I guess it's not. This one's really low, 360 by 180, and it's blurry. You see how blurry that is? I can double click on anything inside the images tab and take a look at those images and use the same navigation controls to go in and look at it. But see, it's just blurry. It's just color. It's making sure the color gets in there. But then for the reflection, go ahead and open that up. This will take forever because it's a 4K image. Much, much higher quality, right? And then we have the 16K one, which would technically be, you know, like a backplate, but this is a spherical. And so you can layer these up to make sure that everything renders fast. This is all going to be very relevant, of course, you know, for baking, things of that sort. You can definitely bake your light maps for engines like Unity inside of Modo. I've seen some really good applications of that because Modo's got really, really nice freaking lighting. All right, so let me just go ahead and come on back over here, and let me take a look at... I can also grab materials right there and select it here through the GL view. Ah, there's my wooden house and my wooden planks. See, it selected that material that's turned off, that group that's turned off. It knows it's there, but it turned it off, so it's respecting it at all times. And I can go ahead and throw these all back on. All right, so basics of the shader tree again. We're going to get on to render outputs in just a bit, but let me go ahead and launch the preview renderer because I want to show you some really, really insanely cool stuff as far as how this all actually behaves. All right, and so we have this material here that is causing us all sorts of problems because it's massively reflective. I made changes to that, and I probably want to bring that all the way down to 1%. And I like having a little bit of Fresnel, and that's just me. And of course, any of these different channels are bakeable. And that's where you would do this through the render outputs. Like I said, we'll be getting to that in just a few moments. And I want my diffuse amount to probably be more around 50 or 60. I was kind of trying to show you something a little bit more metallic. You see, as this refines, and I zoom on in here, I want to show you these wood boards because I really like these wood boards. They're using a single tiling texture, as you can see here. If I look at it, especially through here, you can see the line for the tiling textures. Well, we needed to throw something together fast. So we tiled textures over all these boards. But at the same time, we need to add a certain level of visual confusion to make sure that that kind of is interpreted correctly. And there are a lot of easy ways to do that inside of Modo. Like, for instance, these worn edges that you see around the wood boards down here. That's the type of thing I would waste way too much time painting. Also, the fact that here in Render, as opposed to here in the actual GL view, you'll notice that you don't quite see the tiling as clearly, do you? That's because of the variation texture and the nice painterly style worn edges on this wood are actually because of the occlusion shader. And these are two things I use like crazy. And as of Mari 3.0, because Mari 3.0 allows for baking from Modo into Mari, it's included in Mari, you can use Modo's rendering for baking. This is something that you definitely want to be able to create presets out of. Because, all right, so we're taking a look at our wood right now, and I want to make some changes to this. I'm going to turn off my occlusion shader and my variation texture, and I'm going to reset my render so you guys can see the actual difference. Definitely a lot more boring, not nearly as interesting as it was. I'm going to throw my Fresnel and all that on down so you can really see this a lot more clearly. But it has more saturation, and it also had more variation. And the reason for that is the variation texture. And so what I can do is I can toss that on. And then once that's on, if it doesn't update for you, you can just go to Options and reset the actual render itself. And now you can actually see that there's much more saturation in these boards than there are down here. And I think this is extremely cool. I can do some really neat things, like if I select the variation texture itself, this is an item you come up to add by Add Layer, click on it, and you come up to, I believe it's processing, yes, variation texture. And then you end up with a blend mode. Right now it's set to multiply an opacity. I want to just layer it over ever so slightly. And then this gradient down here. My variation source is set to mesh part. And so what that means is that if we have a layer with a whole bunch of different individual pieces of geometry in there, you see this board here, it may be in the same layer as this one, but because they're not welded together, it's an individual mesh part. And that's set to variation source mesh part. It could be particle, could be texture particle, could be item. And it is automatically choosing from this gradient from white to black to red and adding that to each individual board. And so if I want to, I could actually even turn on current layer overlay inside the preview renderer. And check that out. I love this. The thing that always drove me nuts when I was like learning 3D and dealing with shading and stuff like that was like, I can't see what I'm doing while I'm doing it. It's like Lightwave 12, 13 years ago. You had to wait for it to render. But I wanted to see how the textures blended together and stuff like that. What did the texture actually look like originally before it was blended? And current layer overlay lets you see that. And so I'm looking at this as though it's not even blended or there's no opacity. This is the raw settings. And what if I wanted to add another keyframe right here? I just hit middle mouse button to add a keyframe, move that on over, and I'll just change the color over to green, and now it's randomly selecting from white to black to red to green. And of course we can tweak these values and see how it affects the actual randomization of the textures. And so it's a really useful texture for a very useful effect inside of Modo to create randomization over your surfaces. It doesn't have to necessarily be for all these different wood boards, things of that sort. But at the same time, it's one of those things that no matter what you're working on, being able to add variations per part, great thing to have to be able to add quickly and easily. Now the next one, like one of my favorite things in the world, the occlusion shader. This thing is just so great. And now you saw it added those nice worn edges right here. Let's take a look at the current layer overlay. And so here's the effect that's going on. This is what's actually happening with it not blended. If I select the occlusion shader, you can see down here we have it set to invert, a blend mode of add, and opacity of 30%. And so it's laying that color over basically this little brown color, since that's color 2. And there are different types. Right now it's set to convexity, so it's finding the convex components. The distance is 200 millimeters. Maybe since it's kind of artifacting it around here, we might actually want to bring that down to like 50 millimeters. And so it's always scale based, and so you can kind of tweak and tune that. But one of my favorite ones is actually downslope. And if I come over to downslope, you can see that it actually bases where it adds that color on a downslope. You can really see it up here. And if I expand this occlusion shader, you can see that there's actually a procedural nested inside of here, right? So let me just switch this back on over to convexity. There's so many different options here and so many options down here. If I turn off that hybrid layer, it actually has a pretty strong effect on the occlusion shader itself. And so if I turn that on again, you can see what is actually happening here. We're using that hybrid this is the actual hybrid itself, and it's masking out the actual occlusion elements right there. And so if I go ahead and reset that, perfect. And so you can actually see how that's operating. And so you can use all sorts of different procedurals. And like, what if I just turn this off, I yank this out, toggle that off, I wanna add layer, enhance Modo textures. We have lots and lots of procedurals, and it's amazing how much you can achieve with procedurals only. We're going to be talking about this more next month, but my opinion, and it's been supported like by a lot of people in the work I've seen, is you can get 85% of the way there just using procedurals, and Modo shading system is really powerful for that. You're not limited by resolution at all. So let me come over to, I want a noise. We have lots of noise, and I'm going to use one of the ones I use a lot, multifractal. And in this case, let's go ahead and see how that multifractal is actually looking for us. And all right, you can kind of see it in place. Look over the texture locator, and I want to throw that down to, I'm going to guess, 300 millimeters. By the way, on any of these group channels means channels that have relationships, right? If you see this little widget on the side, that means that these channels are linked. And you can actually click on that, and you see now it's equal, so that'll make all of them equal to whatever you enter here. Right here, it's kind of like that infinity symbol. That means they'll be proportionate. You can add, and so make sure you know about this. Something I use all the time and always forget to tell people about. But right now, there we go. That's a lot clearer. I can come on over to my texture layers, and you know what? I think I'm going to want to modify my bias and my gain. Okay, it looks like the bias needs to go down, and the gain needs to go up because I want to use this as a mask, right? So I really want to have, kind of black and white textures. Let's see. Let's also make some changes. Noise seed, I'm not quite happy how that looks, so I can change the seed there, modify that very, very quickly. And, I think I just need to make this smaller. And so again, I hit the gang-related edit controls, and I'm going to set that to 500 millimeters. If you have caps lock on and you hit MM and it's two capitals, it's going to throw that to meters automatically. And so, no, 50 millimeters, my mistake. There we go. So now we have something much, much broader, and I'm too picky about this stuff. I just am. I'm sorry, but I'll just drop that gain down ever so slightly. And we can pause this. Don't always have to, but it's good practice. And all you have to do, I'm going to undo that, is take a layer, drag and drop it on top of. And you see we got these drop actions. That's new to 901. It actually helps you do a lot of stuff rigging-wise really easily too. But it's used in so many ways. And I'll just drop that on there. And you see it got nested inside of the occlusion shader. And now if I unpause that, you see how the nice worn edges now are being masked out by my procedural. And I can continue to tweak and tune that to be like, oh, whoa, whoa, whoa. I want to make sure we get more of that color in there, but we saw that variation. And so being able to, you know, use the geometry to help you in producing your textures is massively useful. And this is something that, you know, I'm finding that I'm developing systems around inside of Modo because of how many things are available to me. And that occlusion shader is so much environmentally based. Texturing is based on the attributes of the geometry, right? Like if it's really bumpy, if there are like cracks and crevices all over the place and stuff like that, that's what makes a material look really real and part of the real world. And building out these layered materials like this, really, really helpful way of being able to develop things. Now, let's go ahead and, I mean, if you notice, this is just clay shaded. That's because I brought my material inside the item mask. But let's do something really kind of cool. I'm going to take all my materials right here, and I'm going to drop them into the wood planks, and they're masked out, and I'm going to turn them on, and so it's in place. Now we have an item mask, and then we also have the polygon tag mask right here. Now what if I wanted to, for some crazy reason, add another layered material on top of this, like dirt or something like that, right? So I can go ahead and select my first item here, even though it's not being used. I probably want it in the group, and I'll come down here and shift select down here at the bottom and select all my items. And I can just go ahead and hit Control G, and that will create a group for me right there. Isn't that nice and useful? And you know, you see how I get that multi-fractal here in the group? Well, that's one of those things where it's actually telling me what is masking this entire group, right? Now, what if I wanted to go ahead and add another group? I don't want to group this item, so I'd add layer and group. And so now I've got another group up on top of it. Right, and so inside that group, I want to add layer a new material, and wow, now it's overriding it because this group is above this group, right? And so now we've got just this basic clay material on top, and I can go ahead and drive my diffuse amount on down, maybe get my actual diffuse color down. I kind of mix these all together, and I'll throw my specular amount on up, and you see those reflections starting to actually come through from the environment. And what if I wanted to actually mask the second group from this one down here? We're actually then truly creating a layered material. Now I can come up here to add layer, enhance Modo textures, noise. Again, we'll use multi-fractal just because I seem to use that for everything. And you want to change the effect. This is how you alter the shading attributes for, you know, images, procedurals, stuff like that inside of Modo, inside of the shader tree. You just right-click on the effect. Right now you can see it's set to diffuse color. In this case, you know what, I want to come over to my shader control, and I want a group mask. And so now it's saying, hey, I'm inside this whole group, and I want to mask between these two items. And you see, now we've kind of got this layered shading. I've got to change my bias and my gain. And there we go. Now we have a layered material with, you know, a metal, which doesn't look all that metal-y, but it does look more so as we move around, on top of a wood. And you can keep on building out layered materials this way, right? And I've even gone so far as to build out a few, like, almost environmental, you know, presets. I think I did, at least. And so I'll come over here, and you see underneath my materials, a lot of these materials came from the share site, like this aged stone one on our site. We have a share site for people who own Modo. Yeah, I mean, huge amounts of scripts, huge amounts of materials, lots and lots of models and objects. In fact, one of the presentations we're doing for you next month, the artist who's doing it, he's like, oh, do you have a model for me? And I sent it to the share site, and we found a great one, perfect one for him to work with. We'll see if he actually goes with that or not. But what if I wanted to have, like right here, I've got dirt one, dirt two, dirt three, and dirt grouped. These are a bunch of dirt materials that I like to use for layering, and I can just drop that right on top. Now, I believe it might have accidentally nested it, and so I'll just go ahead and drop that right there. And so now we actually have, where is our dirt group? I think I just put it in the wrong place. One last try, all right, guys. So I just drag that, drop that into place. Why doesn't it like me right now? I have a feeling it's just putting it in the wrong place. Yeah, it's dropping it into my item. All right, let me just drop this right up here, up on top. Wow, it's just adding my multifractal. Something is going on here. Let me try this one over here. Yeah, it's just adding. Okay, you know why? It's because it's just an occlusion shader. My mistake, I thought I had these all grouped up, and it wasn't necessarily. And so let me go ahead and delete this. My mistake. It's just one of my clumsily put together presets this morning. See, I dropped that right on top. And you see it's got an occlusion with a multifractal. If I actually want to see exactly where that thing goes, it's going to drop it right down there. You see there's my dirt one. It dropped it at the bottom. And now I can go ahead and drag that into place right above my wood planks, and let's see, right above, right inside my wood planks, above that group. There we go. That occlusion layer is already there. And now, if I go ahead and start the render up, you see I've got dirt all over the place. I've got too much dirt. But you know, if you're in a really sandy area, that's not exactly all that impractical. And I can go ahead and maybe lower my occlusion range and get that to be a little bit more precise, a little bit tighter, and you know, that could have its own bump and things of that sort. And variant scale, this is really great. My variant scale is a little bit on the high side, but as I add variants, you can see how it actually adds. I just went way over 100% and how crazy it goes. But if I go up to, like, you know, close to 100%, you end up getting almost procedurals added to that, and added variation added to your textures really quickly, really easily. I think that's pretty freaking cool. And so we could just continue that process of layering these on up, and, like, yeah, let's go ahead and take a look at that dirt too. And yeah, there's my occlusion that just popped into place, and throw that up on top. And that will continue to modify and alter the shading of these surfaces. And so it's one of those situations where I like to, you know, convince people, like, hey, you know, just build out base materials. Like, okay, you have granite, but then on top of that, like, make a dust material, a chunky, like, raining dust material. Like, what if you have a lot of dust, but it's like a rainy season, and, like, it turns into, like, really, like, chunky caked mud on a surface? You can build those out and layer and layer and layer and have that sourced with the occlusion texture, based on the geometry of the actual surfaces. Wow, we have spent so much time on the shader tree. Okay, so we need to get onto UVs. This is going to go past 45 minutes, apparently. We're going to talk about the UVs themselves. Now, the last thing I want to show you with this is, because I showed you how to build out a layered material. Now, let's just talk about an actual layered material that is a layered blended material. And so to do that, I'm going to create a new scene, and I can hit Control N for a new scene. Remember, inside of Modo, I can have multiple scenes open all at once, which I already do. And just to kind of have something to show you guys, I will go ahead and come over to my preset browser. Doesn't this make life so much easier? I'll go to Organic, and I'm going to grab some of my human meshes, or not organic, I'll go to Human. All right, and so now down here, I'll double click. This automatically adds one of my presets. You see, this is great for small teams. You can host the preset browser on an external server and have everybody on the team saving presets to the preset browser and everybody pulling from it. Now there's a nice little basic head. The modeling on this, it's like the old school sub-D modeling techniques, and it's brilliant for that time period. Every time I look at it, I'm just amazed. All right, so if we go ahead and launch the preview render and take a look at that, clay shaded character, right? So let's come over to the shader tree, and you know what, I don't want to use the actual default head material that's right there. I'm going to delete that, and let's go ahead and group this first material. So Control G, and I have a group. I'm going to name this diff and SSS, and inside of here, if I go ahead and launch this, let's go ahead and make some changes to that material, right? All skin, diffuse amounts around 40%. There's kind of a gradient based on an angle of incidence as to how it behaves. That's a deeper skin shader, though, or a more complicated one. But okay, so we drop the color on down a little bit. And one thing that's interesting about skin in particular is skin doesn't really have much of its own color. It's really kind of gray and blue. Wouldn't even hurt to have a tiny little bit of blue in there, because skin is fundamentally dead. What makes skin look alive is the blood pumping through it. And so if you want to add some subsurface, I think my roughness is good down here, by the way. I also want to be in my physically based model. Love the physics. See how much of a difference that made just like straight off the bat? It's like we'll go back. Physically based, so much prettier straight off the bat. Love it. All right, so material transparency, and then down here for subsurface amount, let's go ahead and switch that on over to, in this case, I usually kind of start up around 60 to 80%. And so there we go, 60%. But now we need scattering distance, minimum, maximum. So let's go ahead and set that to, I'm just going to be a little bit more dramatic here, and minimum 1 millimeter, maximum is 1 meter, way too high. So 2 millimeters, or let's go with 3, like I said. We're going to be a little bit more dramatic. Change the color on over that top layer. This is usually where I make sure I have kind of like a skin tone. And so there we go. It's already looking a lot prettier. My specular mount's way too high, too. I like having some Fresnel, so 50. Fresnel makes everything look a little bit prettier. And now we already have a basic skin shader. We have subsurface. But we want to have a layered subsurface with each one behaving differently per layer of skin, right? Because we have 3 primary layers of skin in real life. So let's add, or we can just duplicate. We can add a material and group it, or just duplicate this, right? So I'm going to duplicate it. And now what I want to do is I want to make some changes to this. I don't want any diffuse. None. No specular. No Fresnel. I don't want any of these settings to have any values except for subsurface, because now we're just adding a second subsurface layer. We've established our diffuse values and reflection and stuff like that. And we just want to make a second layer that is now, we're going to go with mid SSS instead of lower. And so I'm going to change the value here. And this is where things start to get much redder. It starts to get a lot oranger, right? And so a nice, really rich color. Now, one of the things that's interesting about subsurface, especially, it's kind of getting off topic with games and stuff, but you know, there's more subsurface in games. You have a subsurface amount and you have a subsurface color, but the thing to remember is that if you add black to a subsurface color, then it's just there's no subsurface, right? Now the problem that we have here too, I want to get that orange back, is it's not blending these two together. It's not adding the subsurface value of this one to this one. Now what we can do is we can actually blend these two groups together, but this requires a special shader, all right, or a special shader organization. And we want to take the entire group. You see I've got an item mask here for the preset. Drag the entire group up above the base shader. Now this base shader is only affecting any materials below, which is materials, in this case, assigned to the base material, which is a default material. And if I had any other materials, it'd be beneath this base shader. But we need to give a shader to these, to this item up here. So I'm going to come up to add layer, special, and shader. And now we have a shader here. I can right click on that and duplicate it and bring it on down to this group. And so now we have a shader telling each of these groups how to behave. And we can, with this shader, say, hey, remember it, you know, controls how. It's like, in this case, we want to control how it's blending. So we come on down here and we say, I want you to add or even screen. Now you're not going to see it in the viewport because it's a layered material. But you see how much different that looks just straight off the bat. And if I turn that back to normal, it's just what it was before. And an add, now it's blending those together. And we can take this further. You can have a third layer. I'm not going to get into it. But I'll just show you one of the other important aspects of producing really nice shading. That third layer would be very red also, by the way. And you would change the settings for this, the distance on this one, like the amount would be probably like 40%, and I might go a little bit redder on this. And the distances, you want them to mix between each other, so 2 millimeters, and I'll go with 5 millimeters, and things start getting really nice and clean and rich, and so very, very useful in that sense. All right, so I can blend these all together and manipulate the way that they blend together based on the actual shader itself, if that makes any sense. All right, and pretty cool stuff. Really easy, really fast, and you can produce some really, amazingly complicated effects using this layered shader philosophy. Now, the other thing that you can do is you can right-click on this, and you can go ahead and add a color. And this is how I define things like an environmental texture that I layer on top of everything else versus the actual base texture itself. I'll show you an example of that too, but it's going to take a few seconds to load up. So I'm going to go ahead and close the scene on down and show you some of the UV stuff. All right, so we're back here inside the this basic environment scene, and you know, this scene we actually used to bake all the lighting, all the textures, everything down to UVs and sent it over to Nuke. Great for a VFX workflow. And David V is going to be ready as soon as it's ready to start. So I'm telling him 15 minutes because I gotta show you guys UVs. All right. So a lot of UVs had to be done really, really quickly. And so let's talk about kind of hard surface, environmental style UVs. And so let's come over to the UV edit component right here. And so this is the layout that is specific to UV editing. Whoa, big surprise. And I'm going to select this item right up here. And if you want to access your UVs, underneath the item list and the shader tree, you have these tabs, and it's underneath the list tab, all your vertex maps. UV maps are a vertex map. And you can expand those. You can have as many UV maps as you want. But you'll notice I've got these two UVs, and they're both identical. It's because of other demos I've done. If you want to create a new UV map, I'm going to go ahead and say new map, and I'm just going to go ahead and enter in whatever name. And you tell it what type of vertex map. It doesn't even have to be a UV map. We've got lots of vertex maps you can do cool stuff with. I'm going to say OK, and here's my empty one. Now, this UV map that was already created, well, that's how this is being mapped onto the surface. This is how these textures that you see here are actually being generated on this surface. They're all being UV'd into place with mass textures exposing different textures like I showed you before. But we need to be able to generate the UVs for this really, really fast, right? Or we want to be able to. And they're not bad, but they were generated crazy fast. So here's an empty one. I'm going to go through exactly the same process as was used for this UV map. And to do that, let's come to the UV projection tool. You have a bunch of options for UV projection. Right now it's at the planar, and so it's along Y. If I click here, okay, that's a planar projection. If you see that red, there's an option in here that show overlap. It'll show up as red, and that's underneath options. And you come on down here, show overlap. And there's so many other ways of going about it. You know, spherical, I don't know why you'd want to do that with this. But the one I want to show you is Atlas. And Atlas, there you go, one click. And so I'm going to undo that. And I'm going to use the UV projection tool, Atlas mode, click, bang, done. And, you know, it was really smart. Like, if I wanted to go ahead and select an entire island, you can see that each island did a very good job of deciding where it was going to separate things automatically. Those are welded vertices inside the 3D view. And so, yeah, I mean, you know, very good job for a quick Atlas projection, especially with structural objects. And it goes a lot deeper than that as well too. I mean, you know, what if we weren't happy with the packing? Usually the packing by the automatic packing with the unwrapped projection isn't the best, and you can use the pack UVs tool. And the pack UVs tool, I can actually come in here and it's like, all right, you know what, I'm getting the feeling I want these to be oriented vertically, so I'm going to change my direction to vertical. I do want it to pack, I do want it to stretch, I do want it to orient. The packing tools will, you know, help arrange that all for you. And there you go, I'll say okay. I'll try that out. Not a big fan of that either. Let's go with horizontal instead. And there's also auto, which is what it did. You know, I'm actually happy with that. That makes sense to me. It's not fully utilizing the UV map, but it's the type of thing where maybe I'd grab like the roof or some of these other beams and I start filling that UV map up. But there's some aspects of that that make a lot of sense to me. And if you want to preview what your actual UV map looks like, again, you come back to the shader tree. And so I'm going to come back to hit F6, open up the preset browser palette. Underneath the images section, towards the bottom, there's UVs. And these are UV images that help you see distortion. I can drag and drop that right on up to the top. And you see that populates. I can see what my distortion is like and any changes I want to make. If you want to be able to see that with smaller squares, all I have to do is come on over to the actual texture locator. And so you see how I get the plus sign in the shader tree next to the image? It's at the top, so it's overriding all these materials. All of them technically get it, but this is the one that's assigned to the correct UV map. And so if you see this texture locator beneath, which is also over here and the item list. It should be right there underneath the textures folder. It usually drops it in there automatically for you. Then underneath that, you can come down to your horizontal and vertical wrap. If you see you got a lot of stuff down here, I can hit the equal sign. Remember, gang edit related controls. And I'll set that to 6. And so there we go. We've got much more tiling. And yeah, okay, it ran it all over everything. But you can see now much more clearly what your distortion on your UVs is actually like. And what if you wanted to do something like, all right, so let's select poly here. All right, so it's that one, right? And I also want to play with this one. All right. You can double click on any island in the UV view and it will only select the island. And I shift selected and double clicked so it maintained my other island as well. I'm going to shift H and hide everything just in the UV view right here. It disappears here too. But what I want to do is I want to figure out, all right, I'm selecting these edges right here, right? It's like, okay, so it's that edge. I want to figure out how they connect up. And so that means I could probably just bring this right on up here. What if I wanted to connect these UVs together? And so what I could do is I could select one edge, two edge, three edge right there. And what happens when I select that one? Okay, I don't see anything, so I'm going to leave that alone. But you see, you get this orange selection for what I selected and then this blue selection because in UV space, when you unwrap something, well, you split these two sets of edges apart, but they're actually only one edge. And so this represents what you selected, that you're, you know, hey, you're selecting these edges in the UV view. Well, it corresponds to these. And what I can do is I can go ahead and have those edges selected and just come on up to move and sew with options. And I can just sew or move and sew. And so I want to move and sew. And I want to connect to unselected. The purple ones are unselected. And you know what? Things are to scale, but yeah, go ahead. Thank you, Moto. Scale it. So it's toggled on. And so there you go. It just moves that right on into place. And the UV view just operates like anything else does. You can just select an edge with the same tools, move things around, have all sorts of crazy fun. And so really easy manipulating UVs very quickly and easily. Unhide everything. Wow, it's all overlapping. I'm not happy. Pack UVs horizontally. Hit OK and let that go ahead and go through the packing process. I think I had something selected, so I'll try that one more time. Pack UVs. And there we go. So it went ahead and packed them for me. Now there's another option too for you Mari users out there. UDIMs are awesome. UDIMs are multiple UV spaces. You can come over into options and properties. I won't go into too much detail here, but underneath properties, lots of options for how you display your UVs, and especially if you're going to deal with UDIMs, it'll increase the U and the V, and so now I'm exposing more spaces just to make my life easier. And I could use the Pack UVs tool, use our new feature 901 Pack Region to tiles, set my tiles to, you know, I'll go to like 4 and 4. That's a lot. I hope I even have enough for that. But now I'm packing that to 16 spaces automatically. And so dealing with multiple UDIMs is, you know, as long as you have your islands, it's a one-click affair. It's just, it's freaking wonderful. I mean, awesome, awesome, awesome. All right, so I'm going to close this scene on down and show you some organic unwrap stuff. We would have a hard time going through all the UV tools, even in this time that we have allotted here. There's just a lot. And it's really, really very deep, very interesting how far you can take just this one feature set in Moto. So let's go and I'm going to open up a super basic mesh. I had a cooler one I wanted to show you, but everything's set up so I can stream, just, you know, go straight through all this stuff. And so I'm going to go ahead and search for my pelt example. And there's my pelter test and my pelt test component. This is actually a preset in the preset browser. And that link to that image was lost because of all the places I've had this file. And I want to have that rainbow image right on top. You see, nothing's happening. If you come over to the list view, well, there's something happening, right? That's because it is now being projected as solid. And so if I come on into properties, take a look at my actual texture locator, right, which is selected, and take a look at the projection type underneath the texture locator. That's where you find out if you have your image is assigned to a UV map. Right now it's set to a cubic, not even solid. And I can tell it to be assigned to a UV map. I can tell it which UV map, in this case texture, but texture is empty. All right, so I already have, on this very basic mesh, some edges selected as a selection set. I use this all the time. So I'm gonna come down to edges, by selection set. I can just hit this plus sign right here, and that is going to select all my edges for me. Hey, select my edges. Why aren't you selecting my edges? That would be because I don't have the object selected. That's a good thing to do. And so plus selects all my edges. And you see how it's selected all the way down the back, in between the legs, around the feet, and around the hands. And this was like an initial test. I didn't think it was going to work. But I wanted to see how well I could unwrap a full figure, essentially, especially with fingers and toes. Never gotten that to work really, really well. It's a tough one. But I'm going to show you how to go ahead and get a beautiful unwrap and also turn it into a macro. And so we have our actual UV map selected. That's good. That means it's showing up here. If you don't want to see the image, come up to options, and you could tell it to show image. Don't show image. Thank you, because I find that just a little bit jarring. And now we can use the unwrap tool. A lot of people think this is a pelting tool, but all it is unwrapping. You want to use a lot of tools together. And so I'm going to come over to a method of angle-based. I just like angle-based initial projection of group normal. And just to show you this, if I use planar projection, and I'm down at zero iterations, and I click, you can see that it is planar from Y, or planar from Z, or X. And that's your beginning unwrap position. If I go to group normal, you can see how, you can kind of see the shape. It's like it's looking at it from here. Modo decided that the average group normal is this view right here, and that's going to be the beginning of where it unwraps. And so as I click and drag, just left click and drag, it just starts unwrapping it, live. And I happen to know I want this to be around 1,000 iterations, so I'll just throw that up there. Not too bad, not too shabby for just, one tool, a couple settings. I don't want sealed holes on just because I don't want them on. And yeah, did a nice job, but still some problems, lots of distortion in the size of the hands, size of the head, and stuff like that. We still have lots of work to do. But this is where you go ahead and you tell it that you use the relax tools. And so the combination of the unwrap tool with the relax tool helps you get basically a pelting tool, essentially. And there's a lot of modes for relax. Very worth looking into these. I want to get into the one last one before we stop this. We're running over time, but that's fine. I want to give you guys information. So UV relax tool, adaptive mode. Make sure you try this out. This adaptively relaxes your mesh based on the size of one polygon next to another. And so it does a better job of getting everything relaxed, as though the polys are all the right size. Very good. Does a very good job of it. So now I want to, I think everything here is all good. I want to set my iterations up to 250. You could just here, starting at zero, left click and drag, and you'll get a preview of this. Probably don't want snapping on, but you see how it's adaptively relaxing? Now, I happen to know that around 250 for this model works really well. And so there you go. I can just click there. We get a nice relax, maybe go all the way up to 500, and it'll go a little bit further. There you go. And see, we've got a beautiful unwrap that if we come on over to our image, and I want to grab the texture locator, make those much smaller. You can see what a nice job that did unwrapping a very challenging mesh. While low poly, very challenging. And so I have a bunch of scripts that I use for this to do it automatically. And so to kind of show you that process, I'm going to show you how to record a macro and then add it to your interface. So let's come over to the list view. I want to clear this on out. I want to make sure that I have my edges selected, because selecting your edges, this is something I just set up as a selection set to make my life easier to start off with demoing. But when you select those, those edges, this is the user input component of the whole process. You're telling it where to unwrap, so I need those selected. Once those are in place, let's come on down here to this little button right down here to show the macro recording controls. And I'll click on that. You see we got that. I'll click on record. And now what I want to do is, the first tool I want to run is the unwrap tool. Angle-based mode, iterations 1000, group normal, and I click inside the viewport. All right, cool. Now hit spacebar to drop the tool. I'm going to hit spacebar again to switch over to polygon component mode, because I don't want my edges selected, because I want to run the UV relax tool now. So UV relax and adaptive mode, iterations 500, and I'll click inside the viewport, and there we go. Beautiful. Ran that. Spacebar to drop the tool. Come on over here to stop. And now that it's stopped, now we want to go ahead and actually save the script on out. Now I can go ahead and click right here to save it, or I can save it right up here through system. All right, so the gear icon down here, save to file, and I'm gonna name that something really unique and save it in somewhere really, really safe, like my documents. And there we go, I saved that macro there. And now that that has been saved, what we wanna do is we wanna call it, because we want that information to be able to use to create a button. So I'm going to clear my UV map, because we're gonna start that over again. I've got my selection. And now we want to run the script. So system, run script. And I'm actually just going to run one of the ones I already created. And so I'm going to go ahead and go to Pelter. By the way, I'll give you guys the script. I actually have a bunch of them that are different variations on it. And I want to run Pelter. And so it's running that. And you want to make sure your edges are selected when you run that, because it's expecting to have edges selected, right? And so one click, it just did that. And you look under here in your command history, and you see that I ran Pelter.lxm. It gives me the actual command. Now, all that command is at plus the location of your script. And I'm just going to copy it to be lazy. And now let's go ahead and modify our interface, right? Here's our UV interface. I want to have a pelt button right here. And so let's come on up to System, Form Editor. And this is the form editor in Modo. This is the superficial view at the interface and all the commands that are being run and used. It's huge. Modo's got a lot of stuff, And some people have a hard time finding their way around here. But this button, Find Form, all you have to do is click on Find Form. This is a form over here. I think I explained that in the first one. Hopefully I did. Anyway, I'll click inside that form. You see it finds the form for me, the UV form. And then now at the bottom of that form, I can say, I want a new control, add command, paste that command in place, which is just at and the location of the script. OK. And I'm going to label that Pelt. And you see now that button's shown up and has a new name. I'm going to say OK. And now I come over to clear my UV map. I'm over to my edges because those are important. I'm going to hit Pelter. And one click pelting tool inside of Modo that I created myself and I don't know how to script. I think that is pretty freaking awesome, actually. And if you want to take a quick look at what is actually going on in those scripts, right? And so I'm going to go ahead and take a look at that Pelter script just to show you. This is something that you would want to edit after the fact because you can make sure all the settings are exactly in the right place. And I want to go ahead and open this up in Notepad. So just give me 1 second while I let Windows know how I want to open this. So where are you? There we go, Notepad, cool. And there we go. That's what a macro looks like from Modo. So tool.setuvunwrap on mode ABF iterations 2000. And so you can actually, you know, set your settings and then unset your settings, reset them back to defaults. And the only thing, I mean, you got a header that just defines that this is a Luxology macro. It's really basic stuff. It's a great way to get your feet wet scripting. It's a great way for me to get my feet wet scripting. But cool stuff that you get to like string together. Now, the last thing I want to show you, UV-wise, because we just got to move on to speaking to David, and we got to get him on the line. He's been bugging me. He's waiting. Let me just open up another scene. I wanted to show you so much more stuff on this. Time just flies. We have to do more of these. I'm going to create a new scene. I'm going to open up our preset browser, and again, over to my human meshes. And let's see. Where are you? I'm in images, aren't I? So meshes and human. Got a nice little basic hand mesh right here. I hate unwrapping hands, or more accurately, I used to hate unwrapping hands. I want to unwrap this hand, and I want it to be connected along the outer edge. Now, the stuff that we just showed you, very applicable with all this, right? And so I'm going to come on over here and start selecting one edge after another. You see, since I selected one after another here, hold down the up arrow key, comes on around, great. Now I want to break this here, and so one after another, and up arrow key, and I'll just hold that. Ah, sometimes I actually nail that where it just comes right to the tip of the finger, sometimes. So, hey, let's use our pelter tool, right? And so I'm going to go ahead and pelt that. What a nice pelt for a hand, right? That's crazy. Now, another thing with the UV Relax tool, and this is why I was saying, play with these tools, please do it. Don't use adaptive mode because it won't work with adaptive, but angle-based works great. You want interactive mode on. I'm going to turn my iterations down to zero, and I want to save constraints. Now, the UV Relax tool has this constraint mode, and I think a lot of people had a hard time understanding how to use it at first because everybody put constraints along the outside edges, and I don't want to be in sub-Ds. And what you can do is you add a constraint, and it'll actually save them. You see I put that out there, and as I increase my iterations, it smooths around that, right? Pretty cool. But I actually found, after playing with this one night, I'm like, that's probably the wrong way to go about it. You know, a programmer saw this and called those constraints, and I was like, wait, what? This kind of sounds like rigging, right? And so with the UV Relax tool, I can go in there and be like, okay, hey, here's the tip of my finger. I'll add one there, and a knuckle, and sort of a knuckle and a knuckle, all right? So we're just gonna lay them out that way. And so you try and figure out where joints are, and I'm not doing a perfect job of this by any means, because I'm rushing. And it'll actually hold the locations the way it would actually be rigged. And the thing is that with a mesh like this, I want to deform it the way that it would deform in real life, even in the UV view. It's going to make my texturing much easier. And we'll pretend I did this with all of these, right? And I'll just do it here just to be somewhat thorough. I don't usually say thorough, but I was just thinking about Big Lebowski. I love that movie. So anyhow, put my points in place. Now we increase our iteration. See how it smooths like crazy out here? So as long as you have enough points in place, now what we can do is we can grab these constraints and start doing things like yanking the fingers over. Like the areas I run into trouble with hands unwrapping is like basically too little space between the fingers, things of that sort. And being able to tweak and tune that in a way where it behaves the way it should while it's deforming is hugely useful. And after the fact, you know, I can go ahead and tweak this into something that I am very happy with. And once I'm happy with that, I can go ahead and drop the tool. I can use UV Relax. I can use the, what if I wanted to rerun it again, right? And so there we go. My constraints come back because I turned on save constraints. It's actually saved as a vertex map. Vertex maps in Modo are awesome. It's one of the things that really makes it special. But what if I wanted to use UV Relax adaptive mode just to clean it up a little bit? And I'll put that down to zero because it's going to base the relaxation on the existing map. And there we go. Now we cleaned it up a little bit, but we still maintained this new orientation that we created. And so, you know, UVs and Modo are cool. It's like what I was saying in the last webinar, Modo makes me feel smart until I see other really talented artists using it. And it's just the way that it operates as you get familiar with it. You're able to put on and string all these things together. It's like jamming with a 3D program, which I think is awesome. All right, so that went to an hour and 10 minutes instead of 45 minutes, but I think it was important to at least go through some of those things. One of the last things I want to point out to you is render outputs. You know, I'll figure out a way to get you guys more information on this stuff. We need more webinars. But render outputs are what define what you see in your actual scene itself. You can have individual render outputs, like what if I wanted to have a render output for my diffuse color, right? There we go. Now we have a render output, and the preview render can view any render outputs that you add. And like things like even like a render output for, you know what, I want some ambient occlusion. Not the occlusion shader, but I just want a render-based ambient occlusion. And I can also view that render-based ambient occlusion, which is great. And interestingly enough, just to show one last thing, if I show enhanced Modo textures and I add like a multi-fractal noise, and I change that to say bump or displacement, well, bump and displacement, even bump, affects your ambient occlusion. It just treats it like it's geometry. That's something that I found out from Shane. Many of you are familiar with Shane Griffith, great guy, very helpful with these webinars. That's unusual in other renders, and it just happens in Modo, and you'll keep on running into things like this. So thank you guys so much for watching this. I hope it was helpful, and we're going to be continuing to do more of these, and they're going to be here on Twitch, and the stream or the recording after the fact will be higher quality, and so we're making a lot of headway really, really fast. And now we're going to call up David Vega and say hello. And so I'm going to add him to our group call that Brandon and I have. Brandon, are you there?
I am here.
Brandon is here. Were you eating?
No.
No? I hear it sounds like you have like oatmeal cookies in your mouth or something.
I do not prefer oatmeal cookies.
Actually, I love oatmeal cookies.
But no. I was not eating.
Hello?
Hey, what's going on, David?
David.
What's up?
Cool.
How you doing?
David, this is Brandon. Brandon, this is David.
Oh, nice to meet you.
And David,
nice to meet you too.
This is the world of people checking out Modo. I'm not looking at Twitch right now, so I don't know how many people are watching. But Brandon, if you're looking at it, can you just ask everybody, can they hear David and can they hear you?
Yeah, can everyone hear everyone here, Greg and David as well, in the chat?
Oops, don't want to show you that.
All we need is one post that says yes.
Just a yes. Just a yes.
Just a yes. Just yes.
One yes.
Or two.
I could deal with two.
Oh, we got one.
We did? Okay,
yeah.
Good. Everybody's clear.
Oh, we got two.
Two. All right. Well, wow. That's all we needed.
That's great.
All right. Well, David, thank you so much for hopping on with us. You know, I know you're a busy guy, and I was telling people in the last webinar how this series of webinars all started up, and it has a lot to do with you. And yeah, it does. I mean, you know, we had a discussion last year. I guess it was in Florida at the at that one event at Miami-Dade Community. Miami-Dade, MIA thing. Yeah, and it kind of spawned out of this one conversation that we need to do more webinars, show more people about Modo. And you're not a Modo user. And that's why I wanted to talk to you, you know, because there are a lot of people who aren't Modo users out there. But even when we go on these trips with the founder, we meet a lot of people who aren't. And it seems like those conversations usually lead to cool things like this. Mm-hmm. But we have a series of questions we're going to start up with. And, you know, I've been talking for 45 minutes, so I'm going to let Brandon kind of start off asking you a few of these questions, because an artist like yourself, you know, it seems like you learned how to be a 3D artist. You participate in a lot of different groups and organizations, and now you're a professional. And that's something I want to help other newer users understand better.
Okay.
Yep.
Awesome. All right. Well, David, pleasure to meet you, and heard a lot about you from Greg already. So just wanted to start off with just some sort of Q&A with you real quick. What do you do work for right now?
So right now I work with Rockstar Games, and I'm a technical artist. My primary job is to build tools for, like, you know, Maya, whatever we use.
Nice. Awesome. Awesome. And how are you liking your time at Rockstar so far?
Oh, it's great. Awesome. I love it. Cool.
Have you played a lot of the games that that you've worked on there, or tools?
Yeah.
Awesome. And so, as far as your background with SIGGRAPH, what do you do primarily for SIGGRAPH?
So with SIGGRAPH, I got involved as a student volunteer back in 2011 when I was still a student, and it really exposed me to, like, so many people, and so many connections that I never would have. That I loved it, fell in love basically with, like, the whole organization, the whole mantra. And when I came back, I got out of school, I looked into my local chapters, right? And then from there, I met all these great local people that I didn't even know lived, like, in my backyard. Dean Leon, he did the visual effects for Lord of the Rings. He's one of the chapter members, right? And we also had a guy come to the events. He was from Blur. He's like, but he moved back to Florida. And then we also met a couple of people from Activision. It's you never really know, like, who's around
until
you
start
getting involved with the community. And then through the community, I've also met people like Greg. Obviously, I wouldn't be here without SIGGRAPH, right?
Definitely.
Yeah.
That's so cool. Yeah, you never know who's just around the bend, who's working for who, and then it's good to build up community that way. It's just good to get together with other artists and see what they're working on, and you know, see what knowledge you can, you know, help spread to them, and also what knowledge they can spread to you. So that's always a good thing. Awesome. Did you see yourself getting involved with SIGGRAPH earlier on in your career? I mean, has it always been on your sort of radar?
I mean, it honestly wasn't on my radar until I became a student volunteer.
Right.
Because that was such a great experience. As I just mentioned, even just being a student volunteer, you work SIGGRAPH, right, the conference. Mm-hmm. So through there, you're already meeting a bunch of people at kind of high places within the industry. And because you're a student volunteer, you also get extra sessions where you meet even more people, and then you meet other fellow students, right? Mm-hmm. And because it was so great, I decided I want to spend more time and give back, right?
Yeah.
Because I understood, like, even though I was sitting there, I knew there were other people, that if I got into a position where I am today, I want to be able to help them out and get them to where they want to go. As well as let them know that. Because another thing that SIGGRAPH really opened my eyes to is, like, we're not just film and games. We're all these different, you know, industries, medicine, fashion, like, architecture. Like, these are things people usually don't consider when they're going through school, because we're all, like, you know, I just finished watching, I don't know, Star Wars, for example, and it has such great VFX, you want to make the next Star Wars, and we don't realize, you know, I could get into 3D printing and make bio 3D printing, like, make bones and
take
people's
lives? Yeah, bio 3D printing is really big right now. Well, 3D printing in general is really big. No, totally. I was just at a design conference for SolidWorks World back in February, and they had a lot of different ways that they're 3D printing objects now, which is super awesome.
Yeah, great. And then you never, like, And the other big thing is these hubs, like for these other industries, are not where the film hubs are. Film hubs are like London, Vancouver, LA, True. New York. But not everyone has the option to move to these places. Mm-hmm. I've met a lot of people who have families. And for them, it's really hard for them just to say, you know, I live in this great place where I can afford to do freelance. But if I move to a big city like New York, I'd be working full time and barely affording to keep my family, you know, to the same style of same lifestyle that we had.
True.
But then it's like, hey, there's these other industries around me that need my skills. All of a sudden, you find yourself quite happy where you are, and you're still living your dream or working what you sought out after, just not the same way you thought it would end up.
Nope, I completely hear what you're saying. That's awesome. And I believe, Greg, you wanna ask some more of the questions real quick?
Actually, I'll just you have so much charisma, Brandon. I think you'll ask the questions, and maybe I'll chime in. Charisma, you ooze charisma.
What is that word?
You ooze charisma.
Kidding. I know what that word is.
Yeah, no, Brandon's known for his how personable he is. While you guys chat, you know, so we have something going on the video, I'm gonna go ahead and like just sculpt something. So, as you guys are chatting, you people in the Twitch channel, I'll throw it up just so I can actually see it. And I'll choose one thing that somebody says to start sculpting on. So let us know. What do you guys want me to sculpt? I'll choose one during the next 4 or 5. So continue your interview. I'll chime in from now and then.
All right. We'll do. So getting back to actually some of your schooling, where did you go to school and when did or how did you learn 3D primarily?
So I went to Full Swing University. I started around 2009 and then graduated 2011. Their program is very technical in the sense you get a lot of the technical skills, not particularly the artistic ones. Mm-hmm. But they still have like some sort of they had some more classes or whatnot. And going through the school, I thought, you know, when I got in, I thought I was going to be a game artist, you know, being a modeler. And then I'm like, maybe I want to be an animator. Switch my focus to animation, and I hit the rigging course where I was introduced to Python and rigging. And I just fell in love with the idea of like programming and being able to like, if I do rigging, then I can make a script that does my rigging and I don't have to like ever do a rig again. It's wonderful, right?
Nice.
Like the one hit button on. Obviously, that's not how life works.
No.
But yeah, I got really into programming, and then I continued through my studies, so I graduated with a rigging demo reel. But I just kept on, you know, studying Python and how to code.
Awesome. Well, that's it. That's a very unique story. No, that's pretty awesome. Yeah, I definitely sort of fell in love with rigging at a later age in my career as well, and found some really cool, unique aspects for it. So real quick, just to get back to the chat. We keep on seeing some orcs. So it started off with an orc for you to sculpt, Greg, and then it turned into a robo orc. So let's try a hard surface.
I already clarified. I'm like, yeah, let's just go with an orc. We got 45 minutes. I'm not gonna.
Oh, so, yeah. I just saw you in there.
No, it's all good. I'm getting started on a basic
Greg
orc.
All I see is the foundry events.
A simple orc. It's interesting, even just chiming in really quickly on what you had to say there. One of our other presenters, who is a character technical artist at Raven, same story it sounds like, you know, like started learning 3D, started realizing the capability of automation, started playing with scripting, and then just bam, you know, it just exploded. I find that fascinating. Can you kind of elaborate on how that transpired? Because a lot of people are very intimidated by scripting, myself included, you know, and I'd like to hear how that came to you so easily, or maybe it did.
Oh, that's really simple. I'm a really lazy person. So when it came to scripting, I just thought, you know, I could put a lot of time, which is the opposite of being lazy, into this one thing, but then I can do it again at like a fraction of the time, right? And I also really like the idea of puzzles, like figuring things out. And that's why rigging was so interesting. At the same time, in programming, it's a lot of the same things. You get a request to make a tool, and you're like, I don't know how to do that. How do I make Maya do this? How do I make this thing talk to Maya? Or how to make Maya talk to that? And so through baby steps, he's kind of like, okay, I learned this concept, so I'm going to take it and use it, but then I need to add something new. And you just do it again and again and again, and all of a sudden, you've learned all these things that you didn't realize you've learned.
It's interesting.
And problems that all, Yeah.
Oh, and it's interesting you bring that up because, I mean, that's one of the things I was talking about regarding UVs today, and it's just Modo's macro system, which is just firing off a whole bunch of commands, you know, from a text file. But I had the same experience, even though I'm not much of a scripter at all. It's just the ability to, you know, string these things together, automating things. I was lazy. It's like I realized, hey, wait, I'm doing the same thing every day. Why don't I just you know, make this something that I can click once?
Mm-hmm.
So real quick, just you know, sort of focusing more on that the rigging aspect, and were there any other artists that obviously there was Rich Hurry and the Master Rigging course that came out that really inspired you to do that? Were there any other favorite artists that you were looking into at that time that inspired you?
I remember, like, in my rigging course, whenever we'd had labs, you would put a demo reel from someone in the industry, and I would always see them, and I'd be thinking, you know, that's really cool work. But at the same time, like, the people that were motivating me the most were, like, my other, you know, the other students.
Sure,
like,
sure.
My friends. Because I would see them get better, and, like, I want to do better than them.
Yes, there's
like a
mini
competition type of deal.
My best friend is my greatest competitor.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
Oh, that takes me back. That's good times. That's awesome. Yep, I have the same thing with Greg. I see his work, and I just like, okay, I got to get in there. I got to get better.
And then I'm mean.
And then he's mean. No, it's totally useful.
Brandon takes criticism well. I got to hand that to you. You know, anybody here, like, yeah. If anybody here who's listening is, like, contemplating being an artist and, you know, on the fence about it, whatever, most important thing you can possibly learn how to take and give critique.
Yeah.
You know, that is nothing more important.
It's very true. It's very true. So, did you see yourself? Well, no. Actually, I already kind of covered that. See, some of these questions kind of go in the range of you've already answered some in other regards. So let me just go back towards here. Are there any sort of game genres that you sort of lean towards?
I think, like, I guess hack and slash. Because I like the open world games, but at the end I kind of grew up with fighters and hack and slash games. So those are the games that I primarily like. I'm also a really big Nintendo fan.
Oh, nice.
So
nice.
Yesterday they had the Nintendo Direct and they made some announcements, and I was like, you know, I'm hyped for the game. and those games are like the exact opposite of what I work on right now, right?
Okay.
Kid-friendly, what I do is not kid-friendly at all.
True. What was the first video game that you ever remembered playing?
Super Mario on the NES.
Nice.
How about you, Brandon?
Oh, I don't know if I should. So I remember Space Invaders on the Atari 2600.
Atari was mine too, man. I still remember it. Like, I remember seeing Pole Position in, like, my brother's friend's house, and I still remember it. I was 3 years old or something like that. I couldn't even hold the freaking controller, but I remember, like, I want that now.
Yeah, totally. Actually, I have to correct myself. It wasn't Space Invaders. I remember seeing a commercial for that. The first game and actually game system I played was Pong, the original system that you had to, like, with the little tong cable connections that you had to hook on the back of the TV and then screw it in with the screw, where it was just an entire system. That was the game. It was super awesome at the time because I felt that there was something so large with these two paddles. It provided me with thousands of hours of entertainment. So, yeah, there was Pong. I'm gonna go there. I'm really dating myself with that. That's really.
So, what was it about Super Mario that caught your attention, David?
Oh, it was a gift. That was the thing, you know. But at the same time, it's just, you know, you're a little kid, and someone gives you a video game, you're just gonna be like, you never seen nothing like it before. Your eyes just go like, "Wow, what is this?" And then you just all of a sudden start spending hours on like a game you can barely beat because you're like five.
Uh huh.
Right.
And you have to figure out where every warp zone is. I mean, that there's nothing more important.
I used to get a headache because I would try to like put myself on the role of Mario hitting his head on so many blocks. I think it was just a little bit too much. Too much fourth dimension there. So, let's see here. What's your favorite game in the past 5 years? Considering Well, I'm guessing you're very busy, you know.
Yeah. With all the stuff. Well, I mean, honestly, it's Super Smash Brothers. You know, it's I love fighters.
Now, is that the
I
new
love
one?
Nintendo. Yeah.
The new one for Wii U? Okay. I have not played that yet.
There's a lot of streams here on Twitch of that game.
Ah.
A lot.
Wait, isn't that the one with 8 players?
Yes.
Okay, I have played once at a party.
Yeah, it's a great party game.
Very inebriated.
Especially when, like, with friends.
That was awesome.
And people start drinking and they start trash talking.
Yes, the trash talking and the copious amounts of liquid consumption is always crazy when it comes to Smash Brothers. What's your favorite character in that game? I have to ask because I'm a Smash Brothers fan myself.
You know, it really switches. Lately, I've been playing a lot of Toon Link.
Okay.
Toon Link is really good, but other than that, I also use, like, Little Mac and Captain Falcon because, you know, they're the best.
Nice. Well, I'll take you on as Morph.
Oh, there you go. I'm sorry, but I'm going to win.
Brandon, you say these things. You said this about Counter-Strike, and then you apologized later and made excuses.
I never apologized.
This is true. You made excuses.
I did make excuses about Counter-Strike.
Yeah. Yeah, that was kind of pwned.
We still haven't played against each other, and we'll just leave that for another conversation.
All right, fair enough.
So you've been in the industry pretty long now, and you've seen some pretty big changes. Specifically, mm-hmm. the rise of mobile and indie gaming. Has this changed? Mm-hmm. Has this changed development, game development in general? And what other changes do you feel that this would create in the future?
I mean, it's really interesting because with the rise of mobile gaming and more importantly, like indie developers, companies are now leaner. Obviously, there's also the change in the way we market our games. Now it's all about the microtransactions. How do we keep a game living for longer, like longer amounts of time? And I feel that certainly haven't been in South Florida area and trying to, like, help the people that are interested in making games, like, start their own companies and so forth. You kind of want to figure out, like, what's the best way to get into it, like, get into the industry or breaking in, right? Because it's really difficult. It's hard to make games, and then it's hard to make games that people will love.
Sure.
And then the other thing is, how do I make profit off these games?
Yeah, because with the, it's still about the bottom line.
Exactly. So I met with people that they were able to get some money making knockoffs of other games, but that wasn't what they wanted. And then others started trying to make their own games, or completely original content, but are obviously having a hard time to get it to the masses. Right.
True.
Social media is great, but it's still a lot of word of mouth. Like, you know, I heard my friend is playing this game, all of a sudden everyone in the office has downloaded the app.
Mm-hmm.
And then how do you convince someone to spend money on something they don't need, right?
Mm-hmm.
And how did Minecraft ever happen? It's one of those questions. Like, you got a game developer who, you know, just recently outbid Beyonce on a home in Hollywood. You know, it's like, that's the fantasy. But at the same time, exactly. And there you go. Call it out, Brandon. But I mean, you know, that kind of scenario is just like, could that have happened 30 years ago? Could that have happened 40 years ago? Not in the same industry, I don't think.
I think also we see a huge influx of copycat games, of the Minecraft copies and the survival game copies. It's like, hey, let's all make a copy of this game. And that also overshadows, puts a shadow over other people who were, you know, coming out with original ideas. So that's harder
gameplay, gameplay elements like that making their way into other big games for, you know, good reasons. Yeah. Like, I mean, you know, even Fallout 4 has some Minecrafty elements, you know, that can't be ignored. And it's become basically my favorite part of that game. I'm making a city. You know, why wouldn't I? You know, can't wait.
I blame Greg for my addiction to that now, too. So thanks, buddy.
I did guide you through it so you didn't waste time.
I've already wasted an entire town.
Yeah, I guess
you had no idea what happened. They're like, you took all our stuff. I'm like, yeah, I had the user for parts. I'm sorry.
Yep. Well, now we know what Brandon would do if he was president.
That's not true. I'm not. No comment on presidential stuff.
Yeah, we're not going to talk about that. But anyway.
Gotta be safe.
Politics is not a safe topic on live stream.
So, you know, getting back to the Florida Game Jam stuff, one of the things that I was really interested about when I came down to see the event you're putting on last year was, like, straight off the bat, when I walked in there, you had, you know, initial startup presentations going on, and you had some people from a local game studio that had done exactly what you're talking about. Started up a real game. And the guys that were participating in the game jam, who, as I got to know them over that weekend, you know, they're people who are, they're trying to, you know, cut their teeth on games. And, like, being able to see, you know, presentation from other people who did this successfully, I just thought that was really great that you were able to throw this stuff together. How long have you been organizing stuff like this? Because you're really good at it.
So, I mean, honestly, that was the first game jam I had organized.
Nice.
The previous year, I had attended to another one, but I've also been helping out with other SeaGraph events that we hold in the South Florida area. And it's just about really finding out, like, who's here, and, like, who would like to present. That's the other nice thing about getting to know, like, who's around the corner is, this is not only that you don't know who it is when you meet them, they're like, you know, we want to help spread out the word that you're here, you know, in the middle of nowhere, Florida, trying to make big things happen. And because it's just amazing, you know, like, meet these people, they inspire you, and you just inspire them back. And particularly Florida, it's in a really odd place when it comes to 3D, or CG rather, because there's a lot of schools pumping out students, but the industry in particular isn't really there. The big dogs are like EA Tiburon in Orlando. And then it's a lot of really smaller shops. So the passion is there. And you need to be able to, at least in my opinion, is to bring out the passion and convince these young people, not everyone's young, but yeah, that it's okay to study this in Florida and stay in Florida, because technology and, like, in your education is now good enough to live on, right? Either from freelancing, making your own games. It doesn't even have to be a game. It's like, all of a sudden, it's like, maybe there's an architecture firm. People are always building houses. Someone's going to need to have a preview of their house, you know, Prebis. You know, learn how to use Unity 3D, maybe learn how to use Modo, make some makeshift house and strap on an Oculus, or not even. You could just make a Play Blast video and show people. And they'll be really, really excited.
That's a really interesting point, a really great one for you to make, because, I mean, I always thought I was going to work in games or film, and I got a job in Chicago in advertising. And, man, I never expected it to be as difficult as it was, because a lot of stuff you got to deal with advertising. But I didn't even think about going into advertising when I was learning 3D, and that just, like, came out of nowhere. And that's one thing I remind artists of, new artists all the time, is, like, you know, keep your eyes open. There's a lot of fields that 3D is relevant in these days. Like, even my roommate these days, he's trained as an animator. He now analyzes heart scans. And he's doing really well. You know, it's a new industry, startup company, all sorts of crazy stuff like that. And his skills as a 3D artist ended up getting him into a medical field, you know, which is really interesting.
No, it is. That's another big thing that's coming out. There are a lot of apps. Just how do you train physicians and how do you train doctors without, you know, doing an operation on an actual human? And then there's 3D, right? So how are you using, so they're using game engines, they're using 3D, whatever they can, to be able to simulate these surgeries before they actually have to do it on someone. Because the other option would be, let's find a dead body and test it out.
And possibly
pretty morbid, in my opinion.
Be put to death like Da Vinci, you know. Unfortunately, we don't have to deal with that stuff anymore. Interesting. So, you know, you're a character TD. Do you do any actual character work, or do you build tools for the character stuff? Because, I mean, you know, I'm a character artist. I love hearing about anything related to it. And just knowing, you know, what your background was, how you ended up really getting towards, you know, the TD side of things and tool building.
Well, I mean, I kind of, like, hinted at it when I said out of school I got really into Python, but I had a rigging demo reel. I joined a group called Red Giant. And they still are working on a short film called Them Greeks. You know, there are some really cool people working on it. And it's a remote project. So I was able to work from home and actively keep my skills up to date when it came to rigging, skinning, and all that. But they also needed tools. So, you know, I knew Python, and I kept doing it on the side, so I'm like, I might as well do it for these guys. So I kept doing it. And then eventually I got some other freelance for other places through them, where I did more tool development and then less rigging. And then I got my job at Rockstar, where it's all tool development, and I just help maintain the animator tools.
Very cool. Mm-hmm. Yeah, one of our new devs, you know, I think I've spoken to you about him, James O'Hare. He goes by Farfare, known amongst the Dota mm-hmm. community and the Polycon community really well. And it sounds mm-hmm. like a similar scenario in that, you know, he started out as an artist. He does great artwork. And mm-hmm. ended up working for Rockstar as a TD of sorts. And,
yeah.
you know, and now he's built all these tools for Modo that are plugins that, I mean, he didn't even yeah. do Python. He did C++ that are now, I mean, indispensable. I mean, God, they're so good. Mm-hmm. And it's something about, you know, an artist, their experience, and applying that mm-hmm. to a technical component, which is mm-hmm. building tools that completely changes mm-hmm. the way tools are built.
Oh, of course. And it's the other thing. It's like, because you're trained as an artist first. You know, the issues
yep.
every artist has. But you also have the technical chops to be able to say, I understand your problems and I can help alleviate them. Which someone that's probably trained as a programmer doesn't understand. They're like, why do you want this? Why don't you use this other option, right? They don't see eye to eye. So you're like in a very, not only is it like a niche field, but you kind of play both sides.
You know, that brings up I'm sorry, go ahead.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's just to follow up on that. It's also... having spoken with a lot more people, I feel that artists, not saying they're getting replaced, but they're just no longer as valuable as they need to, because there are too many artists today that all want the same jobs at the same place. You know, everyone wants to be a character modeler at Disney. And you might get the job, but it might be temporary. Because if you're out, there's literally thousands of people, but once you learn how to code, there are less people who know how to code and how to do art. And the people who get those jobs... because they know art and coding, all of a sudden they're getting the longer contracts with better pay.
That is the strongest argument I've heard.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. Huh.
Yeah, I've definitely been hearing more and more. If you're an artist and you also know code, you are mm-hmm. you're definitely a force to be reckoned with. So.
Now, it brings mm-hmm. up another interesting topic that I think is worth talking to anybody who uses 3D software. I mean, a lot of people mm-hmm. show up on the forums and stuff like that, and you know, everybody's got ideas, and most people have good ideas because they're using the software. Now, you have experience on both sides of this, developing tools and actually mm-hmm. producing artwork. How do you go about communicating to a developer what you want? Because that's something that I find a lot of people have a lot of trouble with.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's hard. I even have issues sometimes when I'm talking to animators. They're like, we want this. I'm like, why? It's like, does it make sense?
Yeah.
But honestly, it's just more like you have to understand the issues we're going through. You have to learn to love like the tool. Like, not the tool itself, but like how it works. Understand what they want. Try to see things through their eyes. And then give it a go. And then... have someone that is an artist test it out.
Very true. I'm just finding that also, you know, I've made the mistake personally. I guess I'll just throw myself under the bus here. And that it's like in communicating with developers, one of the things I'd be like, well, it's wrong. And they're like, well, it's not. And it's like, but it is. Mm-hmm. It's not how I saw it. And they're like, but it's how I saw it. And it's one of these back and forths where, you know, you got to understand that it's two different people with different visions. And then when you talk to them about it, they may have in the implementation of their tool nailed every goal they had, and maybe you had a different mm-hmm. idea, and so that conversation can be very mm-hmm. very different as long as you acknowledge that mm-hmm. you know, especially yeah. as a developer.
Yeah, because it's very similar to like when you're rigging and like you're trying to provide an animator controls. It's like, in your opinion, a certain feature may seem incredible and you're like, you know, I want to do everything IK, and then the animator comes back and, you know, I like FK, so all the work you did is kind of pointless because they want the simple solution that they know.
Yep, and that's...
So maybe one day there might be a point where they use that IK, but it's not really often, you know?
Which really kind of comes down to, like, as an artist, part of your job is to be good at communicating.
Mm-hmm.
True. Hey, real quick, guys, I have some comments and questions from the chat here. wanted to read some funny comments. Codexus says, I'm a programmer. Laziness is my profession. Smiley face. And Playing Risky has a question here. If it's possible to answer, what are some of the tools he's created for Rockstar? That might be hard, and Playing Risky.
That might be, might be stepping outside the boundaries, but
exactly.
You tell us.
Yeah.
NDA stuff.
Yeah.
So, yeah, NDA.
I think that's why I said if it's possible to answer.
How about this? Can we just say really cool stuff?
Yeah. Can you just say really cool stuff?
I make really cool things in Python.
There we go.
Oh,
wow.
There you go. There, see? You've just
no more information needed. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I mean, if you want to be a technical artist, you need to learn how to use Python, because every major software packages, at least that we use, all have Python implemented, mm-hmm. or you can kind of make it Python friendly one way or another.
Speaking of that, do you have any resources that you would recommend, like anything online or that would teach you how to use Python a little bit easier? Or?
I mean,
or do you know of, or have you used any?
Stack Overflow answers all your questions. I don't know. It's really hard because, I had a Python class, and the rest, everything else I learned is kind of like, you know, I had a problem, I had a face, didn't know the best solution, so I looked for resources that kind of helped guide me where I needed to go. And then through those, you know, questions, mm-hmm. I would learn a little bit more about, oh, there's this thing. There's this concept of a singleton. What are classes? Oh, these are classes. QT, what are signals? Oh, these are signals. And it's just like Model V programming. Oh, my gosh. But it's like, you don't. It's just because I had problems where I was trying to do something and my knowledge base at the time just didn't give me enough. So I had to go out of my way and start researching things. And people were asking some more questions. And I would use the resources others had put up for them. But besides that, I think Rigging Dojo is a great website if you're like a TD, because they always have these great classes. They have a lot of great resources. I don't think they do it now, but they used to do this monthly chat where they would just bring someone to talk for an hour, and their talks were like mind blowing.
I think that's a great idea. Great.
Mm-hmm. What else? And then, you know, just if you're paying attention to, like, on Twitter, people on Twitter always mention some really cool tips. And you're just like, oh, I didn't think about it that way before. And other than that, things like, look what you're doing now, Greg, like, this is great. Like, find talks by the Foundry and other competitors, because you'll learn. A funny story. I remember, like, 5 years ago, I signed up for, like, a talk where Christine Middlemiss was saying something about API in Maya, and then it turns out that she was working at Rockstar like right before I entered, and you're like, oh wow, like it's so funny like how you cross these people and they're online, right?
It's a small world. I'm shocked at it. I mean, you know, mm-hmm. like you and I talked last year and stuff like that at the actual event in Florida, and then all of a sudden I keep on bumping into you at SIGGRAPH, and it reminds you how small that group of people really is. It's like you almost can't avoid each other at those events, because there's really so few of us when it comes down to it.
Oh, yeah. Since we're hardcore.
Yeah, exactly, because we don't stop working. And I was actually, you know, you could tell that as you were running around, you were managing all the SIGGRAPH stuff and, you know, making the connections that you needed to make and stuff like that. And so, no, it was really exciting. Mm. You know, meeting and speaking to you, because I'm like, this is one of those people who is changing things. You know, is actually mm-hmm. putting in the effort that's necessary. Not putting in the effort that drives me absolutely nuts.
Mm-hmm. Definitely, and much respect to you know your focus and importance, putting the importance on, you know, training the next generation and helping people out. Because mm-hmm. realistically, it's a community of artists out there and designers, and we need to help each other. Because that's the way that the industry is going to grow. That's the way that we're going to grow, and that's the way that every piece of every material that we put out there is going to be better.
Mm-hmm.
So speaking of SIGGRAPH again, since you're so heavily involved with SIGGRAPH, did you see any technology this year that really caught your attention?
I mean, I thought the VR talks were cool, more or less like the actual. Less of the technical talks and more of like the history of VR, because VR has been around forever. Obviously, seeing some of the things like ILM and Disney were cool. Some of my colleagues might disagree. We all have our own opinions. And yeah, I mean, what I get the most out of Seagraph is always seeing, I think it's less about the talks and about what's going to be the future, right? Because 5 years ago, when I went to my first Seagraph, 3D printing was new, and then they had it, they were talking about it. This year was about VR, and like all the hurdles that has to come up, you have to overcome in VR. What are the things you have to like think about in the future, right? This is such a hot topic. And obviously it may stick around, it may not, but it's one of those things. And also seeing all the great innovations people are like making. There was like one, I think it was a screen by the University of Southern California where you could walk around it and you could see a person like almost in 3D. And that was really cool. You could walk around this image and it's almost like they were there. I mean, not really, but to think there are people trying to solve problems you don't even realize you have. It's like, wow.
And people making things that we saw depicted on sci-fi in our childhood that was supposed to be 200 years out.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and it's all of a sudden it's part of our daily lives. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like Star Trek these days. It's like, I mean, they had to redesign Star Trek. I love the old Star Trek, but there's no way around it. Like movies like Alien, one of my top five of all time. Phenomenal movie. You know, everything works in our world except for the blinky light computers, you know, that don't actually have any real displays. But it's amazing how far we've come, even in contrast to that sci-fi of the 70s, 80s, and even early 90s. I think we have a few more questions there, Brandon.
Yeah, there's a couple more questions. I mean, he's actually covered some
about
of the other
VR. Well, the thing with VR, I mean, maybe we can just touch on that a little bit more, and I'd love to know your opinions on it, because right when 3D started, you know, which is not a new technology, started really kind of being sold to us. You know, a lot of people saw it as, oh, this is a way for TV manufacturers to sell us more TVs. Mm. You know, and I don't know. It's like, yeah, I can see that. Yeah, all right, fine. They want to sell us more TVs, but I love the idea of incorporating 3D and a lot of the research that was done on it that you saw from, you know, that I think James Cameron helped with just to find out how they're going to make Avatar and whatnot, that, you know, 3D, the addition of depth, actually can create memories. You know, it alters how people interpret an image dramatically. It alters how it's processed. Yeah. And I always saw that as a really big, a lot of potential for new storytelling methods and ways. We saw that with, you know, with Avatar as far as immersion, but I'd say even much more artistically in movies like Coraline or, you know, the 3D for the Star Wars trailer. Oh my God. Just pulls you straight into it. And it's like when VR started taking off, I'm like, okay, well maybe this is why 3D didn't take off, because it was around the corner. But do you see this as an opportunity for people who want to be storytellers to have new ways of telling these stories?
For sure. I think any new technology that comes out, it's going to offer brand new worlds to up-and-coming storytellers, artists, programmers, etc. Because it's just a new way to interact, right? Mm-hmm. It's kind of like when the television came out, all of a sudden, it was this big thing. And then when even talking about dreams and how it changes how you dream, when color TVs first came out, apparently people started dreaming in color because before they were used to watching television in black and white.
I had never heard that.
Yeah, it's like one of those things where it's just like, really, and wow. But yeah, it's a difference. It's a big thing about technology, in my opinion, is how much more can we make it where you feel like you're the one driving the action rather than sitting on the side, right? It's like, are you playing a third person? Are you from a third person's view or like first person? And the closer we get to being able to interact more with the content at a more physical and, I guess, intimate level.
That's the right word for it, intimate.
Yeah, intimate. The more of an impact it's going to have on us. Even today, a lot of it's kind of like we're just watching from far away through these controls that are on our hands. It's almost kind of like making art on a computer, if you have an Intuos, you're not looking at what you're making. You're not looking at your hand. And it feels really weird when you're first learning how to use it. Because it's like, I want to make a circle, but like, it kind of works, kind of doesn't. And it's not until you get into, you get comfortable using this Cintiq that you learn how to, an Intuos, but it feels good. And obviously a Cintiq is much better because you're actually, it's almost like drawing on paper. You're able to see where you're going.
It's funny, I've been avoiding the Cintiq just because I don't want to get used to looking back at my hand again. Like, I've gotten so accustomed to not looking at my hand. And I play with the Cintiqs. Yeah. I've demoed them for Wacom, and they're awesome. You know, especially I love the 13 more than anything else.
Yeah.
But it's one of those things, I'm like, I don't know if I want to commit to that yet. But yeah, anybody out there who is a new artist, if you have a question that is like, hey, should I have a tablet? I see other artists using it. The answer is yes. And it's an emphatic yes. Get a drawing tablet, you know. And yeah. Wacom's really one of the best out there.
Here, I use one at work, even though I'm coding all day. I use it because it feels so good.
Huh.
You know.
And you just got accustomed to it while you're an artist, or?
Yeah. It's much nicer than a mouse.
It took me more pickups and drops to get used to a tablet than it did for ZBrush. That just for context, I had to pick it up and try it over and over and over again until I finally. Mm-hmm. Saw all this wonderful art coming from people. I'm like, all right, I just got to commit to this. And it's amazing how it really only typically takes like 1 to 3 days for like, you know, changing your navigation mm-hmm. style or using a new input device. Mm-hmm. But man, that's a painful 1 to 3 days, but it's worth it.
Yeah.
Well, we got some other questions here in the chat group. In the modcast with the director of Maze Runner, I believe that's Wes Ball.
Yep.
They talked a bit about VR in film. What are your takes on this? I know we just talked about VR, but wanted to get that out there as well.
I don't know. I have my main opinion about VR, and we're just talking strictly speaking the idea of virtual reality, mm-hmm. is I think it's going to go to a point where it's going to be great for private use, but I don't see it so much as a commercial solution or something that the average Joe will like. You know, there are a lot of companies ready to invest into VR technologies for like work purposes. So when it comes to like film, I can see it being used on like mocap stages or like by James Cameron, right? That's his dream, being able to be like one-to-one with what I'm trying to film. But when it comes to like actually like showing a film in VR, I don't know. There's still a lot of things, like motion sickness, how are you gonna overcome that? Unless your character's staying still the entire time and you start moving, but you're sitting down, it's gonna feel really weird unless you got other things hinting, and like in real life, hinting that you're supposed to be moving.
You're gonna need seatbelts because lots of people we've done VR tests with just, you know, for fun, and it's like, they almost fall out of their seats. Like, yeah. they're, if you own a business and your business is mm-hmm. VR, then wow, there's some serious liability issues to consider ahead of time.
For sure.
It's very true. I think my milk dud and popcorn game will be a little bit off if I have a virtual reality rig set up on. I will probably be sick and not be able to enjoy my milk duds, which would really make me upset.
I want you to enjoy your milk duds, Brandon.
I think it's imperative. I enjoy my milk duds.
I've seen what happens like when you don't get milk duds.
It's horribly destructive.
Like, did you see Avengers, you know, 2 talking about the destruction in New York? That wasn't Hulk. That was Brandon without milk duds.
Yeah, don't screw with my milk duds.
Destroyed New York. It was awful.
So, we have some other questions here popping up. Let's see here.
We're doing time-wise. Okay.
We've been told that we should really start a podcast.
Okay.
That's what we've been told.
We this is going to begin that notion. And, you know, yes. I like okay, just to let you guys know, we're kind of going off on a tangent. I really enjoyed doing the talk over with Brandon during the first webinar while Tor was working. And I want to do more things like that because it was very loose. It was fun. But I also like, you know, like Barry's presentation from last week, which was just massively informative. So, you know, this is Brandon and I have talked about a podcast, or what we called a Steamcast at the time. And so we'd like to do something like that, but we're trying to figure out a way to multi-purpose everything so we can give you guys content, we can have fun with stuff like this. And so, yeah, if you're interested in that, let us know, and we can try and make more of that stuff happen. Okay, so go on with the question with David. Sorry about that.
Oh, no, the question didn't pop up in there. So I thought it was a question. My bad. So real quick, time check. It is 1:56 p.m.
Yeah, we'll go another 5 to 5 minutes or so, and I'll show the final step of making my orc. The next step I would do for my orc, which this would typically take about 30 minutes, but I'm talking, and then I would retopo it and continue sculpting, because now I got all my forms in place, and I did it in, you know, under an hour while streaming and talking.
You did. It's beautiful.
No, it's not beautiful. It's far from beautiful.
I like it.
But it looks a lot like my gargoyle. But anyhow, go ahead.
In Greg and I's limited experiences with you, David, you seem to be flying from New York to Florida quite a bit, and you seem to be able to organize a lot of events on your own time. How is that, and why is that?
I love Florida, and I wish I didn't have to. If I didn't have to take the odd job offer in New York, I would have liked to have taken it in Florida, right? And I feel that you have to give back a little bit, really work at the roots level. So I just get, you know, small things rolling, and then let the small things start rolling on their own. There are a lot of great groups in South Florida besides Seagraph. There's IGDA just started back up, the Florida Game Developers. There's a lot of, like, I think Girls Learn How to Code. I think that's the name of the group. I'm sorry, no, it's Girls Develop It. There's a lot of things going on, but like, it's going to be a while before, like, an industry really kicks off in Florida that's better suited for 3D, right?
Mm-hmm.
I think the biggest thing around where I live right now is Magic Leap. And while they're big, they're not like that big. Okay. All right.
If you need to go, let us know. We do not want
to. Yeah,
no,
I do. I'm sorry about that.
No, no worries. Hey, thank you so much, David. Really,
yes,
really
you so
appreciate
much.
You speaking to us.
Honor.
And thanks for hopping on. We'll talk later, right. And I'll see you in January. And thanks
right.
so much. Later.
Definitely. Right. Thanks, David.
Okay.
Okay, well, there's the life of a game artist. You heard,
yeah.
I need you now. And that's the way it goes. But David is one of those people who, you know, immediately, the moment I spoke to him the first time, like, this is an awesome person. And the thing that I wanted that last question to go towards is the fact that, you know, I saw somebody who made it, somebody who got into, a studio like Rockstar. And I remember just talking to my friends about, you know, trying to do things like that. And it's just this mystical process that nobody understands how to do. And because there is no way to do it, you got to figure it out for yourself and, you know, figure out ways to make yourself relevant and, you know, improve yourself an artist, stuff like that. It's just the way it works. But I was impressed that David's one of those artists who made it and never forgot about the difficulty he went through getting there. And he flies to Florida to help out people that are parts of groups that he was a part of when, I mean, frankly, it'd be very easy and understandable if he just, you know, wanted to, like, eh, you know, I'm tired and I'm busy these days. I've got to focus on my work. That'd be a fine thing for him to say, but he doesn't. And I think that's a special thing and kind of defines, you know, the type of person who's going to help bring other artists up into the world and the type of person I was desperately searching for, you know,
yeah.
10 years ago. And so those artists out there who have made it, you know, help out your fellow artists, because you just don't understand, or maybe you've forgotten how much it means to them. You know, Brad will tell you what happens when people who admire him, a lot of people admire him, run into him at a trade show. They're a little bit too enthusiastic, and that's just because of how passionate they are, and they're happy somebody's going to give them that time. And maybe you can be one of those people too, if you're one of those experienced folks out there.
Definitely. And if you find an artist out there who's experienced and who's been around the block and is actually willing to give you their time and help you, take advantage of that, because that is, again, just like Greg said, it's a rare thing. You know.
And an artist who doesn't want to give you their time will pretty much tell you, or they just won't reply to your emails, one or the
yeah.
other. And so yeah. it's pretty easy to see. But anyhow, I have a lot of admiration for David. Looking forward to seeing their Game Jam event. And I'm debating doing another dangerous scenario. Which is maybe streaming some things from that event, you know, just here on our
so
Twitch
dangerous.
Channel. So dangerous.
So dangerous.
Well, that's what we. That's how we roll.
That's how we
roll.
That's how we lay blocks.
I know. I don't want to say that in my most waspy accent possible. That's how we roll.
I think we should just walk around London for our conference thing. That's how we roll. That's what we should do.
in really terrible British accents. I see. That's the one they want to clarify. Every now and then, Brandon busts these accents out. I've been told
that I do some good, like a South London accent or something like that. That's what I've been told.
Under the right conditions, I have seen it. Under the right conditions. I have seen it, but at the same time, you know, we do work for a British company, and so, in the interest of not insulting our wonderful British coworkers, our fake British accents are awful.
I do it out of respect. I love accents. Yeah. I'm an actor, so, and I'm about to put on my Darth Vader suit for the rest of the office, which is going to be really exciting. I will send pictures. How about that?
There you go. Post it to the thread. Show people your Vader. Your outer. I was about to say your inner Vader, but it's really your outer Vader, isn't it?
Gee, I'm kind of in. Yeah, I don't really know how to respond to that, but yeah.
All right, guys. Well, didn't get onto the actual Ritapo portion of this little section, but at least you saw a basic concept. What I wanted to show you was some of the things we talked about in the last one, which is using multiple parts while you know, roughing out forms and shapes. As you can see, I was starting to build out the traps and stuff like that. And if you do the whole throw your headphones on, just work and work and work, you can rough out shapes really, really quickly. You know, send these out, freeze them, send them out to ZBrush, use Dynamesh and all that good stuff if you want to, or, you know, use the techniques with Mesh Fusion that I was showing. You can do it all in Modo, especially for you indie gamers out there that, you know, want to, you know, reduce the number of packages you're using. You can get pretty far, and, you know, maybe I'll do more of these little sculpting sessions and actually get ready for it ahead of time, because, I mean, just kind of was thinking about it, I'm like, oh, this guy's going to be looking at a blank screen. That's not cool. Not cool.
I was really hoping for a robo-orc like everyone else was, but it's okay. This orc needs like, to go to a chiropractor and a dentist at this point.
Well, he's got his baby teeth is what he's got. Yeah, he's a lot of work. About 45 minutes is what it is. But fun stuff. And anyhow, last thing to say before we close this off, this is the end of them for December. We're going to be starting up for January. I'm putting together the synopses for those for January. We'll hopefully get those out with invites for next month. Yep. You know, this will all be held here on Twitch. And really excited how this is all going. You guys are really helping make this happen. So please continue to attend, and they'll only get better. If somebody has a great presentation that you're like, I got this idea and I want to show the world, contact us. You know, like, we want to put on other webinars, and being able to find presenters, that's almost the hardest part. So if you want to present and you've got some really great idea, let us know. We'd love to have you.
Family friendly, though. Just going to put that out there.
Yeah, this is true. This is true. Anyhow, and we got other plans. But anyhow, look at my nub teeth. I don't know what those are. Those are like the dullest teeth ever.
I don't know what to do.
I'd get there eventually. Everything needs some work. But anyway, an hour of doodling out a basic form. The idea is you rough out your shape, you hop on into the topology tab, and then you merge those all together, and you start retopoing that, transferred over with background to multi-res, and you can just continue that process. It's great.
Wonderful. I'm going to name him Grork.
Grork? I am going to take that name. You named him.
Grork, the robot Grork.
I will credit you.
You need to make him bionic, because that's going to be awesome.
Okay. All right, whoever suggested the mecha orc, I mean, I know you're just being cruel. Thank you. But yeah, I'd probably do the same thing. Maybe you'll become a mecha orc someday with some hard servicey goodness. So thanks so much, guys. End of this webinar. And we will talk to you guys.
May the force be with you all.
Yes, may the force be with you all. Good luck tomorrow. Survive.